I, Philip Joseph here,
I would like to be judged as being the Prime Minister, not being judged as being part of a government.
We came into government that we had a manifesto and a vision and mission that had been approved by my party, by the highest body.
Parcel 11 has not been in existence. 50 was...
Giant getting bazooka. Spraying, you're spraying big on to knock out mosquitoes.
I have never had a joint account with anybody in my life. Not my ex-wife, not my children, nobody. And I will refer that to the people in this community.
What about the culture of people getting to office and not being effective?
What people become Prime Minister of St. Lucia? I've been the most ready.
Let's do it this Wednesday, because if it's Wednesday, it's Newsmic Alive.
A very good evening to you. Welcome to another edition of Newsmic Alive right here on DBS Television with me, Timothy Pauly. Of course, we go up until 10 o'clock this evening, at which time we conclude with the clip that peaked. This evening, we have a broadcast with a difference. Normally, we focus on things of a political nature. I don't know if there isn't politics in sports, but we'll be focusing on sports from a local and also regional and even international perspective on the broadcast. We'll be taking your calls later, and my guest is no stranger to you. He is Reds Pereira, cricket commentator, and also sports administrator. Welcome to the broadcast, Reds.
And thank you very much for inviting me. I take the opportunity to be here because I've always respected this program being a very serious program.
Thank you so much for your appearance. Obviously, we start off with the announcement of the West Indies T20 team.
Much awaited.
Yes, and it came as no surprise that our very own Johnson, Charles,
no,
made it on the squad. I don't think there was any surprise. Just one, reading the regional press, somebody was saying that there's one omission in their estimation. Vincentian Obed McCoy should have been included, according to some people. But first, in case you missed it, that announcement was made last week. I'm sure if you're a sports fan, you would have gone through the various regional media outlets, newspapers, etc. Or even on the day in question, you would have availed yourself of the opportunity to know of the composition of that team. But in case you did not take the opportunity to find out, let us provide you with that information. The squad or the team for the West Indies T20 World Cup that is scheduled to start on the 1st of June and end on the 29th.
Captain Robman Powell. Vice Captain Alzari Joseph. Johnson Charles.
Given that every.
Roston Chase. Shimron Hetmaya. Jason Holder. Shay Hope. Akil Hossein. Shamar Joseph. Brandon King. Budakesh Moti. Nicholas Puran. Andre Russell. Sheriffane Rutherford. Romario Shepherd.
Clean them up.
So your assessment of that team?
Well, I've done an armchair selection. Mm. And I'm not all of a sudden going to tell you any tales. I actually got the 15 right, but I had bracketed Hetmaya or Mears.
Okay.
Right. I wasn't sure which where they will go. And they went with Hetmaya because obviously the selectors feel that he's got the X factor, he can finish, he can turn a game around in four overs, and he's got to prove it. I mean, they're taking a chance with Hetmaya because his form when played for the West Indies last was not all that convincing, and he's only batted, six overs in the IPL because they keep sending him with two overs to go. So, you know, we have to wait and see. But I think it's a good side. It has all-rounders. It has spin. It's got major power hitters. And I think in Shamar Joseph, if he repeats anything like he did showed in Australia, he could be an X factor because he can bowl at 150 clips and he can bowl people down, you know.
Well, I think it was risky, and the management team, the selectors, and also the coach the white ball coach, St. Lucia's Darren Sammy, would have given that tremendous thought, because earlier on, Sammy was saying it's not a done deal as far as his selection is concerned.
Well, initially he said, you know, he was happy, I can't wait to get my hands on him. You know, he can cause us a selection problem. And then it coincided with his first match in the IPL, where he went 4 for 47. First over, cost 22 runs, then he pulled it back. Two catches dropped off for him. They haven't played him since. But he's an X factor. I mean, he's got to have him in the side in certain conditions. If it's going to be quick, you can have him.
Obed McCoy, that Vincentian left arm pace bowler. I think I read somewhere that the fact that he is a left arm bowler, that certainly he could cause the batsman some trouble, and therefore probably he should have been selected. And we put his photograph on the screen in case you don't know what he looks like. Obed McCoy of St. Vincent.
Yeah, McCoy would have been a good asset, because is, you know, like Stark from Australia, left armer. You have a number of left armers, you know. From New Zealand, you have Bolt, you know. But I think one of the questions mark, so to speak, is his fitness. He has had a lot of fitness problems with the ankle. I don't believe that you want to take that chance. His fitness record was not good. And he hasn't played a lot of cricket for the West Indies of late.
But you see, the thing is with our West Indies cricket teams, we all know that on paper they are very solid. But on the field and in terms of coping with certain challenges and making certain adjustments when the need arises, they tend to be very fickle and unreliable as well.
Well, you know, when you look at this lineup, I mean, there's a view that West Indies will win the World Cup. My approach is a little more measured. Look, there are six teams, including the West Indies, that can win the World Cup. But it's a step-by-step process. When we play Papua New Guinea in Guyana on the 2nd, we have got to beat them badly. We have got to make sure that our run rate is really right up there. We bowl them out for cheap, lose one or two wickets in getting the target. You know, we really have to build in that. Same thing for the other Africa country, Uganda. You got to beat them bad. We have two key matches: New Zealand in Trinidad and Afghanistan here. Those are not going to be easy matches. It's going to bring the best out of us to beat them. New Zealand is a good side. They field very well. Afghan got a bunch of spinners. So all batsmen have got to be able to expect a lot of spin, off spin, leg spin, left arm spin, the case may be.
What's your prediction? Because already people are predicting that the West Indies will make the Final Four.
Well, that'd be great. I mean, in the Final Four will be fine.
And that individual is Michael Vaughan, who made that prediction.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, if the power hitters have their day, they will give the bowlers something to work with. You aren't going to win the World Cup or World Cup matches with 160. You've got to be scoring a lot more than that. You've got to give your bowlers a little bit of elbow room and not be under pressure, you know. So I think that runs from the West Indies, batting deep with their all-rounders, you know, is very key.
What do you think has happened to the West Indies in terms of the transformation from the dismal performance during the 50-over World Cup to now? Has there been any transformation to talk about apart from, I think that the only change would be, or one of the major changes would be the coach.
Yes, the coach has been one change. I think that they've invested in some new blood in some cases. They got two spinners in Hussain and Moti that, you know, are right up there. I wouldn't say world class, but very good, very capable. the attack, you know, you have Azari Joseph, you have Shamar Joseph, there's Holder, there's Chase, there's Moti, there's Hussein, and the batting, King, Charles, Hope,
Charles Turan. Charles can be very inconsistent.
Yes. If the batting comes well, Tim, the bowling will
yeah, but how much confidence do you have in Johnson Charles?
He comes big on the day. He comes big on the day, you know. And he is a big day horse. There's some horses who really run on the day. And he has a key role to play, because in that power play, you need both himself and King to be scoring, you know, 60 and 70 off the first six overs. So you're building a platform. But you know what? On the day, it really matters. On the day, you've got to have, for all teams, you know, performing the roles they should perform. Catching and fielding is very key. You know, you might make a lot of runs and give away a lot of runs in the field, drop key catches. So all that is very important to Darussami, that we excel in all areas.
And the teams, I think, both the 50 international, the 50 over team, and also the T20, they seem to be cooperating with Darussami, working well with him. Seem to have gelled. Do you get that impression?
Well, I think he is a fellow with a fair amount of energy. You know, he's a good man manager, and he is probably getting the fellows to believe in themselves. You know, they believe in themselves. They had a couple of good wins. They beat England. England didn't have the strongest team, but a win is a win. They beat Australia in the last game, but Australia didn't play their horsemen. They didn't play their three quicks. So you know, it's wait to see how they will perform come the 2020 World Cup in Guyana.
Now, in the case of St. Lucia, in terms of preparations, what do you think the level of preparation is in terms of our infrastructure, the Darussami cricket ground?
Well, I was asked to do an interview for GS with the Honourable Minister, and I did ask as many relevant questions as possible. What was the bid like? When the ICC came, what were the demands? You know, do this, fix this. And I gather that they're going to change the lights, right? The lights have been there since 2007. Mm-hmm. That the scoreboard has been totally redone, which was designed by the late Claude Hume. That all the covers for the stands have totally changed, right? The display board, I think, is coming from South Korea, so that's back to the side you expect. The lights are coming from India, and there's an enlargement of the dressing rooms. I think the ICC is looking for more comfort. The seats have all been changed, as far as I know, and there's a lot of electrical work being done, and the pitch has been relayed. I think they're a little short of water because of the dry season, so they've had to truck in water. Whenever the JS will make that interview available, it'll give your viewers some idea, because this is a work site. I live close to the ground, yeah. So I'm seeing the lights every night, right until 4 in the morning.
Now, the first game is June the 15th. We also have 16th, 17th, 19th, 21st, and 24th of June. That's at least six matches that we'll be hosting. That's quite a bit.
Yes, and one of the interesting matches, Australia is going to play Scotland here. Mm-hmm. And I think Australia is going to be a major drawing card. Now, I think the cost of that ticket in 60 or 70 EC for that game. But what is important is the next round of matches, and St. Lucia's hoping to get a quarterfinal. And you know, it could be whoever, it can be India, it can be England, it can you never know who.
What qualifies Barbados to be the host country for the finals of the T20? Wasn't there also a finals in 2007 in Barbados as well?
That ended in a disaster,
mm-hmm.
because the match referee got his calculations wrong, and it ended virtually in darkness. And all the carnival that's supposed to follow just was lost, mm-hmm. in the darkness. I don't believe they'll make that mistake again. And here's hoping on that day, Tim, out of the storybook of life, it started to rain. Why Barbados?
I suppose. I'm sure if Prime Minister Mia Motley is watching this broadcast, she would not be happy me asking that kind of question. But it's still, I think it's worth asking, why Barbados on this occasion once again?
Well, I think the ICC themselves wanted to get the best gate receipts possible. And I think they had that in mind. They have the tourism infrastructure, they have the flights coming in, and Kensington is a respected venue. And I think the Barbados government obviously made a pitch for it.
A serious pitch.
But the ICC had to look at their own coffers, you know, their own intake of dollars, you know.
Jamaica deciding not to bid, to host the matches. To me, that is seriously, that's an affront to West Indies cricket.
Well, I mean, when you think of the great players that have come out of Jamaica, and the government, tourism officials, and various other stakeholders looked at the numbers and said, no, we can't justify this. And a double whammy, they lost the Talibas, because that franchise has gone to Antigua.
Mm-hmm.
So it's really, you know, a question mark of what's going to happen with cricket in Jamaica in the future. They've got three matches coming up against South Africa, West Indies, Sabina Park, so that's a bit of a cushion, but it's just not the same.
Dominica as well, saying no.
I think their plans started a little late. When they call in the contractor says, we can't do what we have to do as required by the ICC in the timeline you have given us. Better they have done that than run into trouble. That's why they're working round the clock at the Darussami. They were doing the Kaimaje Road, they're doing the road in from the fire station, and There's a lot of work being done.
But somebody sent me a WhatsApp message on my program New Spin today, and they're saying we should have cricket year-round, because having cricket year-round will force the government of St. Lucia to fix the roads, you know? So maybe we should have cricket year-round. I'm sure that was tongue-in-cheek, you know, for that individual. The individual's being facetious. But the big question is, why should they take cricket to fix the roads in those communities, the area where you live?
Well, because when you're going to be the spotlight of the world,
mm-hmm.
you know, when you have some of the best players in the world.
So I think it's a worthwhile investment.
Well, that is not for me to say. I mean, I would think that the tourism officials must have looked. I'm told that the bookings, Tim, and if you call around tomorrow, call the Royalton, call Bay Gardens, call the main hotels, I think the bookings are very high. The bookings are very high. I think that the bookings are quite high at Harbour Club. So the indications is that there are people coming. We will have to wait and see. You know, how many people really turn up, you know. and the cost of tickets are going to be key. Afghan West Indies, I think it's $47 US, you know, for the Jonathan Charles. And the way how the ICC has worked it is that it depends on who's playing.
Okay.
The cost of tickets drops a bit, it goes up a bit, you know. And I think when you get to the quarterfinals and things like that, it's going to go up.
What about the because just to expand a little bit on the returns, what's in it, you think, for the host territories, particularly, let's say, St. Lucia, if we had a match involving the likes of India or England?
Full house. Everything full. All those Indians and Saudi Asians who live in North America are going to arrive here, right? Restaurants are going to make money. Taxis are going to make money. You're going to have a full house at the Darussami, and the government, because of all of that, will make money. And later, when the World Cup is over, the West Indies board will get X million dollars. And they obviously will be sharing out to the host countries. You know, I haven't seen anything in writing, but I'm just, you know, being logical. St. Lucia will, in fact, benefit from what the West Indies board will earn.
Now, the other issue is, in terms of the coverage, the TV coverage, folks in India, in Pakistan, those territories would get to see the host countries and what they have to offer. In terms of the spin-off as tourism destinations, what do you think would be the benefits for us long-term?
I think that our ability to attract people from North America, people from the UK. Among the Scottish visitors we're going to have when they play Australia here, we will never ever see that before. I'm not too sure how many people from India will say, you know, let me go to St. Lucia mm-hmm. for a holiday. Because I don't see that in
not
the CPL.
Yeah.
Although, I mean, the CPL puts out a lot of figures, I do not see an Indian posse coming to watch the CPL. First of all, the Indian players are not allowed to play in the CPL, mm-hmm. and that's part of the problem, you know. So I don't see a lot of tourists coming back here from the Asian world, from the subcontinent.
But let's talk sports specifically now. We have produced some international cricketers. But there are some others who certainly have showed great promise, but they have not lived up to it. For example, Kimani Melius. What do you think has happened to Kimani Melius? That by now, shouldn't he have been part of the West Indies senior team, either the test team or even a 50-over team? What has happened to him?
Well, I mean, he was well-positioned. He was the captain of the young West Indies. He was the opening batsman. But you know, I want to go back to Darussami. When Ornis Hilaire and Desmond Skeet de Late and a few other people, Trevor Phillip, got together and said, let's get Darren to go to England and join the MCC ground staff. That's the direction to me that this young man should have gone, to really nail down his technique, You know, I don't want to say that, you know, he stayed in St. Lucia too long, but he needed to have gone away and spent a season playing on a county second division. There's a lot of second division cricket you play where you learn your technique against the moving ball, where you develop your skills. I think that's really needed. And then, of course, started brilliantly 2 years ago, 196, I think, in Grenada, that the injury might have occurred. It hasn't gotten the kind of runs we were hoping for in the 4-day, but a very pleasant, not big up individual. I found him to be a very pleasant individual. He just needs to get back on track. He needs to get
back.
You
think all is lost for him? Because he's still young. He's, what, 23 years old?
Yeah, no, all is not lost. All is not lost. I mean, the 4-day competition is going to be coming back, which unfortunately is not sponsored by the West Indies Board. They haven't found a sponsor. It's a great drain on our coffers, and it's the shortest West Indies season. But I think he's got to look back, look forward to that. I think, my own personal, he shouldn't play the shorter format. It's not his bag. It's not his bag.
You should focus on Test cricket.
Focus on. I mean, I could see him playing 50 over,
mm-hmm.
but 10 and T20. He is forced to do things against his natural skill. You know, his natural skill. You know. It's like asking Lawrence Rowe and Carl Hooper to play 2020. You know, they can't swipe, you know. They can't hit that long ball because they're you know, orthodox players. And he's built on that.
What about young Akeem Ogist?
Very promising. Very promising. And there's Edwards.
He's also a fast bowler, Kenny Clark.
Well, he gets an opportunity. I think. I think he's going to Ireland, which is very, very. I think he missed out a little bit for some reason or the other. He had a trip to India, where he spent a little bit of time working with one of the franchise. In Ireland, he's going to get tracks that are going to suit him. He's going to be green. And the ball is going to move around, but he is someone with some potential. You know, I mean, Azari Joseph is moving on. Seals from Trinidad is having a great English County Championships. I think you just got to be ready when the opportunity comes.
What about the discipline? What about the consistency on the part of some of our players in St. Lucia, generally speaking? So, those guys are showing great promise. I referred there to Akeem, Ogis, Kenny Clark, earlier on, Kimani Melius. But that's the kind of promise that John Eugene, a few decades ago, showed as well. But he never graduated to play at a consistent level to make it to the senior West Indies cricket team.
He was a talent. I mean, I saw him get an innings in Barbados.
Against Michael Marshall.
Against a top-class attack. I mean, it's beautiful.
What is score? I think about 123, something like that.
I can't remember the score. I mean, it's a long time ago.
Yeah.
But he batted beautifully. I mean, there were some shots through extra cover, through square cover, you know. And then he moved on where he captained, I think, in the same year, he captained the West Indies under 23 or something like that in Grenada. But at that time, you know, it was a little hard to get in. You know, it's much easier now probably to get in than then. He just didn't maybe batted well in St. Vincent, I remember, against one of the international sides, but you know, he just missed out.
Managing our players, do you think that is at the heart of the problem? Because if people like Akeem Ogist, they're showing great promise, and Kenny Clark and others are showing great promise, don't you think that with proper guidance and help, etc., that they can move on, as opposed to what many people might expect, unfortunately, that they will just not make the necessary progress?
Yes, I think that the first responsibility is to the player. Fitness. You know, Andy Roberts, Holding, Garner, Croft, Winston Davis, that whole lot, they used to get up in the morning and run. So the first responsibility is to the player, other than running, practicing, you know, living the life of a cricketer, working on your talent. And in these days, it's much easier for a young man to see a lot of cricket. You know, it's all over the place. So you can look at technical things very easily. And there's a lot more opportunity now. A lot more opportunity. You know, they need to be guidance. They need to be a plan for what these guys are doing, where they can. I mean, Barbados are very good at getting their players into the English system. We have got to remember relying on Darren Sammy, relying on people who are in it. No, look what Roland Butcher is doing for Barbados. Roland Butcher just got Oman to come and do pre-season World Cup in Barbados. We need to have a built-in kind of think tank to look to see where these players need to go.
What about the management of West Indies cricket? Because for years now there have been so many reports, so many studies, and about a fortnight ago, you had this CARICOM cricket conference over in Trinidad and Tobago, and you had the same talk. You had a number of stakeholders and ex-cricketers, people who have the status and the gravitas who can speak authoritatively on the way forward for West Indies cricket. This is not the first time this is happening, but I guess what is very predictable is that there'll be recommendations, and those recommendations will not be implemented. How do you address this issue?
The general feeling is that it may be another talk shop. You know, maybe another talk. I remember about 10, 15 years ago, we had a similar exercise in Trinidad where Surbiton, Weeks, and all the greats were still alive. They were all taken there. Nothing came out of it other than maybe a report that is, some shell for the other. Let's see what will happen. You know, let's see what will happen. But you know, our infrastructure, it really needs upgrading. There's a little bit of upgrading going on now in the World Cup, but the infrastructure just doesn't rely on your test ground. You know, infrastructure has to be wider than that. Our infrastructure are probably behind many of the ICC countries.
What about the utilization of those former players? I mean, they displayed the prowess on the pitch, okay, as bowlers, as batsmen, as fielders, etc. Don't you think they have what it takes to also
not use?
Yeah.
For
example, a Clive Lloyd.
The Skerrett administration had talked about using the former players. Nothing really happened to mentor, to advise, right? The shallower organization has also initially talked about that. We haven't seen any of that, you know, the use of the former players. So until that happens, it's just really a good statement in the press, but nothing is happening by using your former greats. And the former greats are getting older. This is the time to use them, you know.
But the frustration is being displayed by a number of CARICOM leaders, whether you're talking about Mia Motley or Dr. Ralph Gonzalez or Prime Minister Rowley, who is the president, the chairman of the CARICOM subcommittee on cricket. But don't you think they need to take it a step further? Who owns West Indies cricket? And that is a big issue people are saying. I ask.
That's a major issue. That's a major issue. That needs to change. I mean, I remember that Trinidad, journalist, a young lady, she just wrote a book on Sir Frank Worrell, Son of Grace. She did an interview with Peter Short, and when she asked about accountability, Peter Shorten, the president of the West Indian Bursa, to whom do we report to? You know, as if, look, we are independent, we are the West Indies board, we don't report to anybody. That needs to change totally, But we'll wait to see what will come out of Trinidad. Up to now, we haven't seen...
Do we know what will come out of Trinidad? Nothing?
We were waiting on the communique. But I will say also, I was disappointed that a lot of independent thinkers, people with a view, who are not anti-board or pro-board, but who have questions and who have issues. I mean, like Fazir Muhammad, Lance Whitaker, Barry Wilkinson. I mean, if you want to push the envelope, I wouldn't mind, but none of that kind of independent type of person, whether it was by design, I do not know. But I mean, a lot of money was spent in getting people to participate in, and I think that some of the writers, some of the journalists, some of the people who day in, day out comment on what's happening or not happening should have been there to have made a contribution.
A contribution was made by former Jamaican West Indies fast bowler Michael Holding, a very emotional one. Let us watch and listen, because he cites a particular experience that he had which he found to be very embarrassing.
Topic of the West Indies Cricket Board and incompetence. Let me give you a story. I won't take long. I was involved with one of the sponsors, an old sponsor of West Indies Cricket Board, Diageo. And they did this campaign. Sir Viv and myself were involved. We did this campaign about walking to the ground, because Johnny Walker whiskey was one of the products. And walking to the cricket grounds. I did this walk in Trinidad with Sir Viv, and we got to the ground. We did the promotion in the morning, and I am driving back to the hotel in the bus with the Diageo folks. And a gentleman by the name of Richard, an English gentleman who was the liaison officer between Diageo and the West Indies Cricket Board, came to me at the back of the bus. I was sitting at the back of the bus on my own. Came to me at the back of the bus and showed me an accreditation printed for one of the gentlemen from Diageo. Printed and given to him by someone from the West Indies Cricket Board. Now we're talking about Johnny Walker. And Johnny Walker was spelled J-O-H-N-N-Y. Come on, folks. You have a sponsor putting thousands and thousands of dollars into your product, and you cannot even spell the sponsor's name correctly. I'm getting emotional about this thing. It hurts me. We need to look after the sponsors, because they are the ones who bring their money. We need to make sure that they are happy and confident that their funds are being spent correctly, that someone isn't siphoning it off, as we have seen. And that way we have a better chance of looking after our cricketers. If there is no cricket on the ground, all this love that Jack Callis and people around the world have for West Indies cricket, it will not last unless we are producing on the cricket field. No one is going to love West Indies cricket for the name West Indies cricket. They loved West Indies cricket for what we produced, going back to Sir Larry Constantine, right through the doubles and Sir Viv and current cricketers. That is what they loved, not just the name West Indies cricket. So if we cannot produce on the field, we will soon die, unless everybody's going to be happy with just having 2020 cricket and there's no true West Indies test cricket and all that. If that is the way everyone is happy with, so be it. But I'm too old for that. I'm 70 years old. I can't adjust to that.
Some people will not understand the pain that Michael Holding is going through, because he certainly would have epitomized, you know, professionalism in the era when the West Indies were automatical winners of various games.
Well, Chevy, he is one who have come out, but a lot of that era is feeling the pain. But you know, West Indies cricket, this tour of England in July, you know, it's going to be virtually sold out in some of the test venues, because the people of England remember the West Indies from 1950. They remember Ram and Vala and the three W's and Ray and Stormare. Then they start remembering the great team led by Frank Worrell.
And that's the era that CLR James would have written about.
Yes.
In the Boundary. Mm-hmm.
And people will still go, you know, expecting to see some of that old class, some of that old brilliant display on whether it's fast bowling or in the field. The ticket sales for Lords, I think, is totally sold out. You know, so that love for the West Indies brand is still there with the generation of Englishmen and women who probably can still go to cricket.
Locally, what do you think about the administration of sports in St. Lucia? I mean, such as our sports councils, our various clubs, the club structure in St. Lucia.
Well, first of all, I want to say that it was the right choice by the government to appoint Kenson, the Honourable Kenson.
A sports minister.
Mm-hmm. He's got the passion, he's got the drive, he's got the interest, and is not going back to previous, and this goes right across, there were previous sports ministers who were also Minister of Education, responsible for culture, responsible for the civil service. Here is a choice of a man who is full-time sport and youth. But the Honourable Minister cannot run sport. He can do a number of things to improve the opportunities, the infrastructure. For the money being spent in the World Cup is not just in the Dharasami, it's going to be right across, which will come out in that interview which I did with him. But our focus has got to be on the foundation. The foundation is weak. I mean, you take the district sports councils, let's say there are 16. My understanding is, and I'm not here to bad talk or bad mouth anybody, of the 16 sports councils, six are functioning. Therefore, in the various districts, you do not have that growth you should have, right? Then I walk with a simple thing called a constitution. The power of a political party, trade union movement, church, whatever denomination, is the cells, is what you have on the grounds spread throughout. We need that in sport. We don't need teams, we need clubs. And unless there is a concentration by the Ministry of Sport, by the National Olympic Committee, by the associations themselves, you aren't going to have the strength in the associations. Strong associations make a strong Olympic Committee, and sport also goes up at the same time. The other thing to me is the associations themselves. There are about 26 associations. How many of them are really functioning, you know? How many of them are really functioning, you know? I'm not here to call names, but John Public, just by seeing one of the programs coming out, will know that X is very active, Y is very active. Some are not active at all. And I think that is a failing. That's a failing to me of not having a club structure that is working. Right. I mean, let's look at physical education. We have two institutions, Monroe College, Sir Arthur Lewis. No physical education. Our source is Cuba. You have to send someone to Cuba. He got to learn Spanish, or she has to learn Spanish. Why not go the Jamaican route? They had the G.C. Foster School that Michael Pear went to, right? Why can't we get maybe six scholarships during the OECS time, the sports desk got 8 scholarships to go to the G.C. Foster. Michael Pear was one of them. We need to have physical education taught at the basic level. I mean, the Barbados Community College, they have a physical education program. We can borrow and modify it to actually suit. I think the Olympic Committee, I am not saying they must change anything they're doing now. They help associations to compete. We go to the Pan Am Games, we go to the Commonwealth Games, we go to the Olympic Games. I'm saying that must stay. But we need to focus on empowering our coaches. The only way we're going to produce more...
How do we empower our coaches? And by the way, we'll open the line right now to take your calls and your comments and questions from my guest, Mr. Joseph Rensperer, cricket commentator and sports administrator.
How we empower our coaches? Mm-hmm. By bringing people to work with our coaches, to work with our athletic coaches, to work with our basketball coaches, to work with our boxing coaches, to work with our volleyball coaches. Jamaica did this. I mean, I must say that we could be another Jamaica. They got 3 million people. But we can empower our coaches, improve the coaching, you're going to improve the standards. We need to have more football coaches train, etc. And therefore, the Olympic Committee has got to put aside a special amount of money on focusing on improving the skills of our coaches.
But those recommendations have been made, I mean, on several occasions before. Why do you think maybe they have been implemented in the past, but somehow maybe somebody has decided to drop the ball as far as this is concerned?
Kim, unless I've missed out, I have never read anything about focusing on our coaches, you know. I mean, our coaches are self-made, people who have managed to pull...
Once again, we'll put the telephone number on screen so that you can call with your questions and comments for my guest. Thank you so much. And my guest once again is Joseph Rensperer. But don't you think that we are leaving things to chance too often, and we have to be more scientific? Our approach must be more deliberate.
Exactly what I'm doing. Trinidad has invested in some international personalities to come and help to train their coaches. Jamaica has done that. Look at track and field in Jamaica. People are coming to Jamaica to be part of the sprint capital of the world. You know, we must have the same approach here. I'm not saying the Olympic Committee must not do what they're doing now, but have a specific focus on helping to improve our coaching skills. It can only be done if you bring people in to spend a certain amount of time working on the basketball coaches, working on the various coaches, and out of the 26, let's say, national federations, you only choose 12, Kim. 12 of them, you say, well, we're going to focus on this. Ones that are grassroots, ones that are male, female. You know, you don't maybe cater for the minority sport initially, but unless we have that happen, we will continue to move on at that slow pace. The occasional Julian Alfred might emerge, Laverne Spencer might emerge, Dominic Johnson might emerge. This way, you will get a lot of talent coming through because the coaching of it is at a higher level.
So what is at the heart of what is the problem? Is it lack of resources, financial?
Well, the Olympic Committee has got their own money. They don't rely on national lottery and things like that. And they have to decide among their affiliates, look, let's put aside X dollars to bring people here to improve our coaches. Get our coaches more qualified, level one, level two, whatever the level they appear. That's the only way you're going to start producing. The infrastructure is also very key. I mean, the minister, I think 2 months ago, was talking about the need to have maybe a small track somewhere around the Bexon area, so that our athletes can, you know, really train. Right now, the Odlum Stadium is, you know, very, very much not really available. They're trying to use it whenever they could. Where does the athlete train? Where does the athlete train? You know, I think the minister was on point that we really need to have a small little track facility, is, you know, somewhere in that area. And that is one example of the infrastructure. Indoor facilities, you know, indoor facilities. We have one. I'm not too sure how often that's used. But when we get these facilities, there must be a program to make sure that they are going to be used. Yesterday I did an interview with the president of swimming. The 50 meter pool is starting on June 1. That will take about a year maybe to complete. I'm not too sure what is the completion date. That will be a step forward. That will be a step forward.
But why do you think the level of progress we are making in terms of sports administration, in terms of implementing those programs that can be long-term effective, why do you think we're doing that in such an incremental way as opposed to doing it and producing some results that are tangible? Because I'm sure from the time you came here in 1984 as coordinator of sports at the OECS Secretariat, to now, where if you make the assessment, I mean, instead of making progress, we certainly have failed.
Well, I think talking to Roland Cox, he points out that from when I came here in 84, about 12 clubs have totally disappeared. You know, the club structure is non-existent, and unless a simple constitution is not demanded, but asks each and every club to work within the constitution, where there is an executive to run the club that will look at discipline, fundraising against the club who is focuses on performance. Unless you have that structure, you aren't going to have the kind of
But who puts that structure in place? Who should be putting it in place?
The Ministry of Sport, mm-hmm. The Olympic Committee. Simple. I mean, I put this together just as a working paper. This is not written in stone. Myself and Rufina Paul, about 2 years ago, sat down and came up with a constitution, which I have sent to just about every department in St. Lucia. It's the only way forward. If we make the association stronger, I mean, you take volleyball for example. Volleyball is not played on in many districts because volleyball is only played on a hard court. Volleyball can be played on grass court. Every district in St. Lucia, volleyball should be played. Basketball should be one of the most thriving sports in St. Lucia. The new association has just taken over. I wish them well, but the last association to be didn't really take advantage of what is a very popular sport among the grassroots, you know. And it's a very cheap sport also, you know. We're just touching the top of the soil.
So without much of a sports culture in St. Lucia, you think?
I would think so. I mean, I think this Pro League is an example of how you can lift standards, how you can lift standards. This is a very good example. If we can use the pro league, the semi-pro league, where they've been able to organize the franchise, they haven't had one game which has been postponed, right? If we can use that example to lift standards, to lift standards of behavior, standards of on time, working with the communities to come out, you know, that is an example that can be applied all around. But unless the Ministry of Sport and the Olympic Committee gets together, we will have weak associations.
Remember, we take your calls during the segment for my guest, Mr. Red Spirara, cricket commentator and sports administrator. We're talking about sports in general in St. Lucia and the sports administration as well. What about things like sports coverage? I honestly believe that this is sorely lacking in St. Lucia. When you compare what happens in Barbados, in Trinidad, in Jamaica, certainly, with your sports max and so on, this is sorely lacking in St. Lucia.
Well, let's face facts. You know, when I came here, you had the Mirror, you had the Star, you had the Voice, you had another paper, I can't remember, Crusader.
Yeah.
Right. You had Radio St. Lucia.
And even regionally, you had Radio Antilles.
Exactly.
Yeah.
A lot of that is lost. A lot of that is lost, you know. I have just started a TV program called Pereira and Company. Mm. And I am focusing on the trending stories. Like yesterday, I interviewed Eddie Hazel of swimming. I talked to Francis Daniels about who's doing well in the Pro League, who's leading. You know, what is this standards like, what the stats is showing. I managed to pull in Chris Wells, the table tennis coach, who does a wonderful job and gets probably not the amount of credit he should get. He had just come back from Santo Domingo, where they took a lot of young people and exposed them there. So that to me is an opportunity, at least, for solutions to hear people answering questions. Not enough. I mean, with all due respect to your news program, you probably cannot maybe cater for as much sport as you would like.
Mm-hmm. But also, I think people in St. Lucia largely, we tend to show our support for certain athletes when they have been internationally. For example, all of a sudden everybody's talking about Julian Alfred, but I'm sure before that people hardly knew of her. And there are a number of other track and field athletes, young track and field athletes, who are showing promise, cricketers, etc. But we are just not investing our time, even as ordinary citizens, and our resources in those athletes, the corporate sector as well.
Well, don't forget, sport is not sexy, right? That's getting the bread.
But isn't it sexy in Jamaica? In your experience, I think you would know. Is it not sexy in Jamaica?
They see sport as part of the culture. The story about Julian Alfred, I mean, is just that she had support, went to Jamaica, was able to adapt to the school system, did well there, and took off, you know. You need to have better facilities for track and field. This athletic association is doing a very good job. They're really been trying to lift the standards. I mean, I've seen their program. I think former star Makiba Al-Seed is a PR. They're doing a wonderful job with the infrastructure for athletics. It's just not there to grow. I mean, the Odlum Stadium is not available, you know. But we have facilities on the use. Our basketball facilities are on the use. I mean, you know, you were talking about empowering coaches. We need to empower tennis coaches. We need to empower our coaches. That can only way forward.
So definitely the picture that you're painting is one where it appears that not enough attention has been given to sports administration, not enough attention has been given to our sporting facilities, the various programs that need to be tweaked. We need to show more aggression in terms of our approach.
Exactly.
But it has to start somewhere. The big question is, where do you start?
The people who are responsible must take their responsibility. You know, if an association is not producing programs where the sport is developing in the various areas of St. Lucia, the Olympic Committee must call in a Red Spur and say, look, you gave us a program, you have not executed your program, what is the problem? Is there any way we can help? That's not interfering. That's not interfering. That is saying, look, you have access to funding. You're not drawing down on your access, you know. The Olympic Committee was able to pull in the Volleyball Association and say, okay, well, we have just helped you to go abroad. You won the tournament. What are you doing? How is the sport spreading? I mean, I grew up in a culture in Guyana where all the sugar estates had volleyball players playing on grass courts. Why can't we have volleyball and grass courts? You don't need an asphalt court. You don't need a concrete court. That is one example. What's happening to road running in St. Lucia? I think this association is trying to reintroduce road running. I mean, the OECS half marathon, which maybe be killer one. Mm-hmm. There were 80 St. Lucians running in that half marathon in 1985. You know, you have to build back the structures. But it needs a program of education. It's got to be a focus on the Ministry of Sport, a focus by the Olympic Committee to get the club structure going, right?
As it stands now, you think that things are done in a very ad hoc manner, a disorganized manner, and perchance we may produce a cricketer or an athlete of a high international standard on the basis of what? On the basis of their own effort, or if some miracle would be performed, but not something that is organized properly to produce desired results?
Well, cricket, I think, now has a development focus with the school in my area, which is now the sports academy. You know, I think there are three or four disciplines there, so that is forward looking, and those people are being trained by the coaches. There is an education aspect to it, so cricket has starting to move to be a lot more organized in development. I would like to see less white ball cricket being played and more red ball cricket being played, you know.
Why?
Because that is the red ball cricket is what will produce your four-day cricket, what will produce your test cricket. 10-10, T20 will not produce test players. You know, it's going to be easy to get sponsorship, mm-hmm. but you're looking at development, you know. No, it's not a development tool. A lot of bad habits playing that white ball for young people. I mean, right now there's an under 23 tournament in Trinidad. A lot of 20-year-olds are playing. I mean, you know, that's a disaster waiting to happen. Guyana's got a T10 going. You know, it's easy to get the sponsorship, easy to get the crowds and things like that, but are you really developing the skills of the game?
But why not give the people what they want? If that's what the audience wants, why not give them what they want?
Well, shall it be? As Michael Holding just said on your show, if that's what they want, that's what they want. Red Spur is someone of the past. Maybe I'm wrong, totally. But I think I am right in saying that, you know, we really need to work on structures And, you know, the Honorable can't do that. He can't run sport for associations. Associations have to run their own sport, have to run their own training, have to develop their own structure.
But why give it to them when they are making a hash of it? Because, I mean, there's so much politics in sports, to the extent I'm talking about people really canvassing, people are campaigning for certain positions. I mean, talking about administratively, in sports, they want to serve in management positions and so on. But do you think that they want to take it to the next level, and that is producing results based on the task that they have been given? But who should be holding them accountable?
Well, right now, tonight, we are semi-holding them accountable. We are asking questions that is not being asked. You know, not being asked. You know, somebody should be asking, you know, how many of your associations are really functioning, you know. What can them do to make them function better? You know, basketball has a volcano of talent that we haven't touched. You know, there should be a lot more basketball being played. I hope the new association is going to move in that direction. I think they had just recently had a club tournament, which is maybe a start. But I mean, I would like to see a Central Castries basketball association. You know, a Beaufort basketball association, a Souffre, all sub associations. You know, so there is growth in the country. Again, we come back to the training of the coaches. If you give the coaches skills, they will pass on those skills to the players. Possibility of scholarships are the case, maybe, you know.
You think that the administrators lack the passion, lack the will, or is it a case where they just don't have what it takes, I mean, as forward thinkers, to do what is required to take the role to the highest level?
I think if the member affiliates of the Olympic Committee was to ask themselves, you know, what can we do to get better as an association, as a group responsible for a sport of a nation. St. Lucia is an independent nation, right? And look at the spark that Julian Alfred has given us. The Olympic in France is going to be watched by St. Lucians in the greatest number ever because of her. If we can start really building capacity from the ground, if you're building a house, foundation is important. You know, you start with foundation. The foundation is what's happening at the district, what's happening at the schools. I'm very happy that we have seen Champs, which is the takeoff of the Jamaica Champs, but it was a step in the right direction to focus on our secondary school athletes. You know, the Souffre facility has been able to allow that to happen, as the case may be. But, you know, I think I would like to see Minister Kenson meeting with the affiliates and say, look, we can all do better. How can we do better? You know, how can we build capacity? How can we spread the sport? You know, that kind of thing. But, you know,
would that be micromanaging?
No. He's not looking to run the sport. He's just asking questions. How can we improve? You know, what facilities you need to improve? I mean, I gave you the example of the district councils. They get $6,000 to help them with their administration.
$6,000 annually?
Yeah, a lot of that money is not picked up. You know, who's suffering? The youth council should have a word. The youth council should pay some interest in what's happening to sport in the districts, you know. What's happening in the netball in this district, the basketball, what's happening to football, what's happening to all the disciplines, you know. we just got to take the whole thing a lot seriously, and I think we need to ask questions and demand a higher standard. I'm not criticizing the Olympic Committee. I'm saying just add a focus on the coaching, a focus on physical education at the two institutions we have.
With regard to coaching, so what we have is coaches who are not qualified, not trained.
No, because they haven't been given the exposure, mm-hmm. right? You haven't been given the exposure. The cricket coaches have moved on in that direction, level one, level two, level three, and things like that. The footballers, I think, have moved on. The footballers, the Football Association has, in fact, I think, put out a statement where all of their clubs have been certified. Now, what that means, I'm not very sure. Whether that means that there is a club structure, there is a committee that runs the clubs, and all of that is applied. But, you know, there is, in fact, some kind of a certification for a B license and things like that in the world of football. But that is not happening across the board. You know.
The Sports Academy made reference to it. How is that operating right now? Because I think when it first came on stream, there's some confusion. You know, that thing about focusing almost exclusively on sports, that is something that is novel to us in St. Lucia.
Well, it should have a component of the disciplines, mm-hmm. whether it's cricket, football, track and field, right? And I think there are three or four girls now who have been brought into the program. But there should be a focus also on education. You know, that would be the total type of institution you want. I can't really answer clearly on that. I know there's a lot of trading going on. I mean, I was asking Alton Crafton to do an interview with him, and he said, no, he's got a commitment to a training program. Mm-hmm. So I know a lot of that is going on. A lot of that is going on.
But generally speaking, what will it take for ordinary solutions to take a greater interest in sports locally? Because I get the impression that people are into the Premier League and the international football and the T20 and so on. But locally, do you think that people have adopted the practice and the discipline that they had, less in the 1980s, of going out there and supporting the various teams? The other thing that would have worked to our advantage is that, particularly at the sub-regional level, St. Lucia is doing very well in a number of disciplines. What are you talking about? Volleyball and football, and to a certain extent, cricket. So people had this impetus, as if they were being rewarded for supporting the various athletes. Right now, I don't think people have that kind of incentive.
No, I think the standard of the club activities, in going back 20 years ago, encouraged a lot more people to go and watch, mm-hmm. watch sport. I mean, I remember basketball, the court gestures and different people. There was a lot of interest, you know, competitions being played and crowds watching. All that has disappeared because of a weak association, you know. So it is...
How is boxing doing, by the way?
Well,
because that's the one omission, because for me in the 80s we're doing very well in boxing as well. At the OECS level.
There's a great development in Beaufort. Beaufort now are producing the best boxers, right? And
I wonder why.
Well, I think they've got the coaching there. We come back to the coaching. There's a Cuban coach which is based in Beaufort, along with some local coaches, right? The name Situt, the former heavyweight, light heavyweight, just stopped. But there's a coaching group there, and I think the the Boxing Association wants to run the Creole Games in July, and I told you that I was involved with Dr. King on an anti-crime program, which Minister Kenton selected for Rosalie, but after World Cup. We just had a pretty good meeting with Dr. Anthony, with all the association presidents involved, and I think boxing is going to take an exhibition there, and in August there will be a summer program for the children of Viewfort and Viewfort North and Viewfort South. So things are happening in that direction, and I think Rise is heading the kind of movement there.
But why do you think we are not doing enough in sports, knowing that the benefits that could emanate out of it, where so many young people who normally, some of them would have the proclivity to get involved in criminal acts and violence and so on, if you keep them in sports, if they keep them focused, they certainly could use their energy in a positive manner. To me, that should be automatic.
I totally agree with you, and that is the plan which was discussed in Viewfort, the fixing of the basketball court, the fixing of the netball court, because you have to have the facilities if you're going to have that kind of response. So it's a plan that is developing. A subcommittee is working on a report which has to come back to Dr. King and Dr. Anthony, and it probably will be, you know, a pilot that could be done in any part of St. Lucia.
Finally, what keeps you going after so many years as a cricket commentator and a sports administrator?
Ex-cricket commentator.
Huh? Ex-cricket commentator.
Finish in 2019.
Mm-hmm.
It's good for my mental health. Okay. Yeah, you know, I'm genuinely interested in what's happening. I still have a passion for it. You know, I try to follow. I do a lot of pro bono work to use Richard Peterkin pro bono free work. But I mean, I report for Jamaica every day, or Guyana every day, Barbados. I do a local contribution to an FM station. No, I think it's healthy, and you can't have double standards. You're gonna maintain, that passion. You're gonna maintain that love, but you accept the realities of what you're dealing with.
Final comments from you, Reds.
Well, I really hope that some members of the Olympic Committee, some affiliates, have been watching the show, and they themselves must have a conversation. You know, I'm not ordering anybody, I'm not saying you must, but the affiliates from the Olympic Committee executive must really ask, now how can we improve our associations? How can we make them stronger, more accountable, spread the sport in the country? How can we improve our coaches? It means putting aside some money, bring in people to train our coaches in track and field, in discus, in shot. You know, the gambit is wide. The gambit is wide. The infrastructure needs to come up. I think you might consider inviting the minister to talk a little bit of the infrastructure. With the money that's being made available to World Cup, it's not only going to be World Cup that's going to benefit. There's a lot of other projects that will benefit.
Thank you so much, Joseph Reds Pereira, for being my guest on this evening's Newsmaker Live broadcast.
Thank you.
And to you, thank you so much for watching. And we certainly will be having another program come next week, Wednesday, because if it's Wednesday, it's Newsmaker Live. Time now for the clip that beat.
Maybe I don't know what Chinese food, Daddy.
You don't know what Chinese food?
Yes.
Well, okay, but Nerit, let's make a deal. If you want Chinese food, spell Chinese food, and you get Chinese food.
We don't want no Chinese food again, Daddy.
You don't want a Chinese food again?
Yeah.
So what do you want?
KFC. Be friendly, Daddy.
Once again, that's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching. My name is Timothy Paul. I'm saying good night and see you next time.
Hi, Philip Joseph here.
I would like to be judged as being the Prime Minister, not being judged as being part of a government.
We came into government that we had a manifesto and a vision and mission that had been approved by my party, by the highest body.
Basel 11 has not been in existence. 50 was
giant getting bazooka. Spraying big on to knock out mosquitoes.
I have never had a joint affront with anybody in my life. Not my ex-wife, not my children, nobody. And I will refer that to the privileges committee.
What about the culture of people getting into office and not being effective in taking?
What people become prime minister of St. Lucia? I've been the most ready.
Let's do it this Wednesday, because if it's Wednesday, it's News Nick Alive.